study. Events and other announcements. Sunday, January 31st, elder elections. Friday, February 12th, men's ministry 6:30, fellowship fun with friends, meals, and message included. Sunday, February 21st, elder meeting. Open meeting starts at 6 p.m. and close at 7 p.m. Why did the unemployment man get excited while reading his Bible? He thought he saw a job.
Blessed morning. Y'all got to make a little bit of noise. Amen.
Amen.
It's a beautiful day the Lord has given us, as always, and we're here in the house of the Lord this morning, we get to worship Him in freedom and truth. Amen?
Amen.
And I personally can think of some worse places I could find myself this morning. Amen?
Amen.
So y'all answer this question with all your heart. Make the tent on the roof rattle. Are y'all happy to be in the house of the Lord this morning?
Woo!
Well, y'all can make some noise after all. Well, don't want y'all to stop making noise. Y'all keep your hands together and stomp your feet and help us out. We're going to praise His name this morning. Amen? Brother Bob?
What you want, Jesus on the main line. Tell Him what you want, got Jesus on the main line. Tell Him what you want, oh, oh, oh. Tell Him what you want. His line is never busy. Tell Him what you want, oh, line is never busy. Tell Him what you want, line is never busy. Tell Him what you want. Tell me what you want. If you want His kingdom, tell me what you want. If you want His kingdom, tell me what you want. Come up, tell me what you want. Come up, tell me what you want. Come up, tell me what you want.
Back up here this week. I tell you what, it's been a while, hasn't it?
Woo!
Woo! Travis and I know a little bit about that band, don't we, too?
Got the band back together.
Rip. Said it, Lord, I'll never let you down. Yes, I thought you couldn't see me. the side of town. Thank you.
calling out to you and me.
I've been hiding afraid I'd let you down. Inside I doubt that you could love me. But in your eyes there's only grace now. You plead my cause, you right my wrongs, you break my chains.
Speak.
myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise, and all that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet I hear your voice, word of God.
Second, put the pause and get the other microphone together, and he'll be taking prayer requests in just a moment or two. If it is your first time here, we just want to say welcome home, amen. So good to have you here this morning. We do things a little differently. We don't pass an offering plate, but if the Lord leads you to bless the ministry in that manner, there's a little wooden church house back there by the back door, and then also we'll be there right after service. If you got any questions, want to ask anything, and get to know a little bit more about us, get to know a little bit more about you, that'd be great. And Brother Bob.
I'm ready. All right. God, let me say this before I forget, because I know I will. Lord's put on my heart, been for a while, to do a prayer booth. I wanted to do it at Walmart, right in between the big doors, but Walmart doesn't, they have, it's against their policy to do anything like that. So then I had an epiphany. I'm going to do it right down at the end of the corner, right here by close to I-20. Put some signs out there that says, prayer booth. You got a banner ready, thanks to Miss Rhonda Goldring and signs. But we're going to do that this Saturday. Unless it rains, unless the weather's bad, we're going to do it this Saturday. So all of you guys, as many as you can, please show up and help out right there. You know, this is something our church can give. It helps the community. We're going to do it in the afternoon. I even thought about doing it on Friday, because that would be a prime time. You know, people's already went through the whole rough week, and they probably need some prayer about that time. So let's make it Friday, not Saturday. Let's make it Friday. They'll come off of 20. We're going to put a couple of signs there, so when they exit, they'll see, prayer booth over there, each side of it, just to get people going. I wanted to say that, because if I don't, then I'll miss the whole opportunity to get everybody involved in that. If you'd like to do that, come see me right after church to be part of that, and I hope a lot of you will. Anybody that's prayer warriors, this is the time for you to shine, amen? It'll be a drive-up thing. We'll have to wear a mask, of course, like and everything like that, but I just look forward. I think God's going to really move in our community, with using Rafter J in that area. Any prayer requests? Yes, ma'am.
Wilma and Pat, and Wilma is in the hospital with COVID. And she also has cancer. And I have a praise. Me and Barry went to the doctor week before last, and I had blood work done. And my diabetes number, my A1C, came back as a 5.9.
All right. Wow. You're done.
So.
Very good. That's really good. Yes, sir.
Healing for the nation.
Yeah, for the nation. Boy, that understatement.
I've been watching the numbers on a daily basis for new COVID cases, and they seem to be trending downward for the past week at least, so hopefully that will continue.
Yep, more people will get shots too. We'll start calling it the Trump shot, just to throw everybody off. Amen. Didn't mean to get political, let's not go there. But anyway, any more prayer requests, guys? Anybody else? Yes, ma'am. Or your daughter-in-law?
Okay. She has cancer.
cancer?
Starts chemo Monday.
Starts chemo Monday? Okay. Anybody else? Nobody else. All right. I do want to give a praise report. My wife is doing much, much better. She's got her out of the hospital last week, and man, she's just doing much week before last, and she's doing much, much better. She wanted to be here today, but her actual official quarantine isn't over until tomorrow, so she didn't want to take a chance. Like I said last week, guys, I'll tell you what, the safest people to be around is me, my wife, my mom, Brian Calhoun, the Gold Ring family. Just we're the safest people to be around because we've already had this stinking thing, right? And it's going to be really hard to catch it from us since we've already had it. We've built up an immunity to it. Any more prayer requests? All right, let's go before the Lord. Father, we love you so, so very much. Father God, we want to thank you for this day. Father, we want to thank you for who you are. Father God, we thank you for your mercy, your love. And Father, we ask especially thank you for your grace that you extend to us. Father God, you heard the prayer requests. You've heard the praise reports. And Father God, I heard cancer. That's one more thing, Lord. Just another word that starts with a C to you. Father God, you healed me of my cancer. And I've seen you do it in this church, not just me, but others. Father God, I can't help to wait to see what else you're going to do in the midst of our church, Father God. Lord, we don't want to leave here the same way we came in. Father, we want to experience you this day, Lord Jesus. And the common thread that unites us all together is your spirit dwelling in each and every one of us. So, Lord, I'm asking that you just have your will and way here today. I'm just asking that you use that common thread just to unite us all together. And may we just praise you in a glorious, glorious, this is one great, glorious instrument. Father God, we thank you for the prayer request, the prayers that you've already answered. Oh, we look forward to seeing the rest of these prayers, Father, what you're going to do. That's what we're going to learn from the sermon today. Lord, your line's never busy. Lord, we can call on you at any time. Father God, I can't help but think about that person maybe here or here today or watching on Facebook or YouTube. Lord, maybe they have an emptiness in their heart. They don't know what's missing. They just know something is missing in their life. Father, I pray they're not... after this service, that they would come to know you as their son, that they would cry out to you and ask Jesus to come into their life and change them. Father, we ask this in all things in your precious son's name. Amen. All righty then. All right. Title of today's message is 1-800-GOD. 1-800-GOD. Called up a place like Home Depot. I'm going to use Home Depot as an example. You ever called up Home Depot? You get that recording, you know what I'm talking about? And it says to if you know your party's extension, call now, dial now. And then they'll give you a whole like four plumbing dial, whatever, you know, this extent, dial this number, extension. You know, each one of them has an extension for plumbing, for all these different things. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Well, God has a telephone number too. Like I said, 1-800-GOD. Guys, his phone is never busy. You don't have to worry about that. In fact, it's Zechariah 13:9 says, they call upon my name and I will answer. You don't have to worry about God hanging up on you. He's going to answer. He's always there. In fact, God is the one unmovable entity in the universe. Nothing can move him. He stays in one place. We stray from him, but he never strays from us. Amen?
Amen.
We get down spiritually, and then he's there, and we cry out to him, and we come to him, but he doesn't have to come to us. Amen? We have to go to him. Romans 10:13 says, everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. And we'll get to more of that here a little bit later. Psalm number 50, verse 15 says, and call upon me in the day of trouble. So when you got something going on in your life, guys, don't hesitate to call God. Why is it that God seems to be the last person we contact when stuff's going on sometimes? You know what I'm saying? All hell's breaking loose in our life, and We're looking to the world, we're looking to neighbors, we're looking to friends for different things just to help us through. The very person that we should be contacting first is the God. We just call him, he's going to answer. That's what Psalm is saying. It says, and they call upon them in a time of trouble. I will deliver you, and you will honor me. Boy, that's the key right there, guys. We have got to honor God. Did you know that everything he's done and will do, continues to do, is to bring him glory, is to show his glory. Our job as Christians is to bring glory to God in everything that we do. And of course he does that through his Son, through the work that he begins in us when we accept Jesus into our heart. That's when he begins that work. Amen. And we're going to see this a little bit apart from him. We can do nothing anyway. But just keep in mind, it's that call, guys. It's that call. We're calling up God, and he's going to start giving us some extension. I do want to mention in John, before we get started, good. See, John's gospel, it speaks about the deity of Christ. Whereas the other gospels, it's kind of a standalone from them, where the other gospels, they speak about God, Jesus, as more of a human standpoint. You know, just... And just kind of starting out from there, going from his birth, the human birth on through. But John doesn't do that. John starts out in verse 1 of chapter 1 of his gospel. Says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. And then it goes on to verse 4, and it says that he is the light of men. And he's the light of the world, guys. And in verse 9 it says, he's the true light. In verse 14, it says that John says that he is the Word made flesh. And of course, in verse 29, he says that he is the Lamb of God. Those are just a few names of Jesus. But I want to in John, we're going to be in the what's known as the seven I Am's in John, and this is where Christ speaks of himself as the I Am. And when you think about the I Am, and I can guarantee the Pharisees, when he said I Am, and would name his, say who he was, that the first thing that they thought about, guys, where their mind went back to Exodus, when Moses was, in fact, it's in Exodus chapter 3, verse 14, when Moses would ask God, well, who do I say when he goes before Pharaoh? Who do I say that sent me? You tell them that the I Am sent you. See, I Am. That's God. You know, it's just a pronouncement. I Am. And that's what Jesus was doing in these seven I Am scriptures of John. So we called up God in your mind's eye. We called up this helpline, this heaven, called up heaven. And we got the recordings that if you know your extensions, the number of your extension, then dial now. But then it goes through a litany of things in order for us to reach these different extensions according to what we need. And the first one is that, guys, when you are spiritually hungry or thirsty, then you need to dial extension 635. We're going to be all in John 635. So turn with me to 635. This is after Christ had fed the 5,000, after he'd walked on water to the other side, and everybody had met him that he had fed on the other side, and they got into a conversation about manna coming down from heaven. And Jesus spoke these words. He made this declaration. This is 35. It says, then Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never go hungry, and he who believes in me will never be thirsty. And verse 44, he goes on to a little bit more explaining this. Verse 44, he says, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day. It is written in the prophets, they will all be taught by God. Everyone listens to the Father and learns from him. Some to comes to me. No one has seen the Father except the one who God sent. He was from God, excuse me. Only he who has seen the Father. Only he has seen the Father, excuse me. I tell you the truth. He who believes has everlasting life. I am the bread of life. Your forefathers ate the manna in the desert, yet they died. But here is the bread of that comes down from heaven, which a man may eat and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. The bread this bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. So, you know, just like physical bread gives us life, sustains our life. But Jesus is the living bread that sustains our spirit, our spiritual body, our spiritual person. You know, I've said this before, guys. If all the spiritual food you get is up here on Sunday, then you starve yourself the rest of the week if you don't get more than that. If you don't open the Word, read the Word, listen to another preacher, just whatever. I mean, the technology is here for you can just even get it on your smartphone, all this stuff. But you need to be fed. So if you're hungry, spiritually hungry, call extension 635. When things seem dark, call extension 812. Turn to chapter 8, verse 12. Then Jesus spoke again to the people and said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Guys, you ever went into a dark room? I don't like dark because I can't see. You know, we don't have the dining room table of our house. It's me and my wife, and just us, and we always just eat on the love seat, which is only a few places to sit there anyway. We don't have, we're kind of limited in space there, but I'll sit down with my plate, and first thing I do, turn the light on next to me, because I want to see my food. I want to see what I'm forking up there, you know. That's just me. I got to have a light on there. My wife, she hardly turns the light on anywhere. She's like a bat. She just likes it dark. Not me. Well, I got to have the light. I don't like to be in darkness. I just don't like it. But Jesus is the light of the world. Excuse me. And to a world that is lost in darkness, Christ offers himself as a guide. That's what that means. If you're walking in the darkness, and the kind of darkness I'm talking about is this world, it kind of gets you down, it consumes you. You feel like you're sure enough in a dark place. But cry out to Jesus. If we call him up and use this extension, that I am the light of the world, then he will come beside us and he will light the way for us. Amen. When you need protection, call extension 10-7. I'm going to start reading in verse 1 and then go and get up to this, but it's what I'm talking about. It says, I am the gate. I am the gate. It's talking about the sheep. It says, I tell you the truth. The man who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is the thief and a robber. The man who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The watchman opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. They call him. They call his own sheep. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. Do you know the voice of God? Do you know Jesus' voice? I know it. I know it. I know it when I hear it. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize the stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech, but they did not understand what he was telling them. Therefore, Jesus said again, "I tell you the truth. I am the gate of the sheep." So Jesus is the gate. I am the gate. All whoever came before me were thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. He will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes to rob, to steal, and to kill, and to destroy. So it's kind of a play on that. And I've jotted down here, this is the... Now, let me explain what's going on here. The sheep pen that he's speaking about is a place where the sheep could go for safety. They had to be led there. Jesus is the gate to that sheep pen. So they could find safety. It's a place where they could just keep them confined, like for at night when they're sleeping. You know, let the sheep rest, and then they would lead them out. It's kind of a strange thing. I don't know if you've ever heard about this, but the sheep, boy, they're dumb. That's one thing. But they know their master, the shepherd. They know the shepherd's voice. I mean, I've heard about this. I've never witnessed it. But they say that they have several herds. I mean, different people have several herds. And they all go into the sheep pen. He's talking about the guy that would the guard there that would open the door and let all the sheep in. When it came time to take him out to pasture, then each shepherd would come up and call his sheep, and they would all follow him because they knew his voice. Amen? But it's a place of shelter. It's a place of safety. I wrote down Psalm 91, verses 14 through 16. It's going to take me just a minute to get there, but Psalm 91, verses 15 and 16. Says 14 through 16. Says, "Because he loved me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him. For he acknowledges my name. He will call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy and show him my salvation." God is there to protect us. Guys, he is there. When we need protection, he's there. He's got a place for us that we can go. In fact, the Bible says that he is our fortress. He is our fortress. He's our strong tower. So we can come to him for safety. Just call. So if you need safety, if you need the protection, dial extension 10-7. When you feel scattered and alone, you call extension 10-11. Let's continue reading there. Now, as soon as I get back to it, some of those times I was kind of silly and just took my paper out too. Continue in 11. So if you're feeling... If you're feeling scared and alone, verse 11 says, "I am this good shepherd. The good shepherd laid down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd who owns the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he is the hired hand. and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen. Talking about us. Before he's talking about the Israelites, he's talking about us now. I must bring them along also. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life, only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it back, to take it up. This command I receive from God. So when we're feeling lost and alone, guys, then our good, we can listen to God's voice and He will steer us back where we need to go. Psalm 23, of course, is the perfect scripture to go along with this. Everybody should know this. It's talking about the shepherd. Jesus is the good shepherd, and it speaks about him. That David's talking about him here, I believe. It says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters." You know, a sheep is, they won't drink from a water that's moving, like a spring that's moving. I think it's because I've heard they can't see the bottom. Something like that. I don't know exactly what. But he leads us beside quiet waters or still waters. He guides me in the path of, it's bright waters. He restoreth my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table for me in the presence of mine enemies. You anoint my oil with, you anoint my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So, guys, if you're feeling lost and confused like a sheep running around, then dial 14-6, extension 14-6. Now, when you feel separated, then if you feel separated, then dial extension. And I did it again, guys. I apologize, that gummit. I got to go back here to let my paper out. So I just want to lose my place, and I lose my place. So when you feel separated, you know, dial extension 15-1. 15:1 says, "I am the true vine. I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch that does not bear fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean." You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me, and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. That's what I was talking about there, guys. That fruit is just us, guys. So if we're feeling separated, we need to remind ourselves, we need to call this extension and realize that Jesus says, "I am the vine." He's the one that connects us all together. And we need to remind ourselves that we are part of this vine. We're not separated. We can't be separated from Him. Amen.
Amen.
Hebrews 15, 5 and 6. Excuse me, 13, 5 and 6. I apologize. 13, 5 and 6. Keep your eyes free from the love of money and be content with what you have, because God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. So we say with confidence, the Lord is my helper, I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? God promises that he will never leave us nor forsake us. We have that promise. Amen. So, if you feel separated, then dial John 15:1. There are alternate numbers. Isaiah 9:6. Brian reads this every Christmas play. He says, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. And the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." So there's some more alternate numbers right there. Several extensions right there, guys, because he is the Mighty Counselor. When you're going through some trouble, there again, that this world brings on us, it doesn't matter what it is. Guys, don't lean on the world as Proverbs 3. As Proverbs 3 says, I'm trying to turn there as quick as I can. Proverbs 3 says that, beginning in verse 4, excuse me, 5. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. So, don't lean on this world. Don't lean on your own understanding, but seek God. Seek God. And he will be your mighty counselor. Amen.
Amen.
When all hell seems to be broken loose in your life, just remind yourself that he is the Prince of Peace. And under him and with him, we can have peace in the midst of everything going wrong. In fact, as Christians, that's one of the ways that we can shine our light. When everything's going wrong in our lives, that we can have peace and that we can have joy. I'm talking about that peace that surpasses all understanding. That nobody, I mean, we just can't understand it. It's one of those, it's that kind of peace that when a lost and dying world is looking at us and scratching their head. Why? They got cancer and they're just peaceful like this? They're going through all this. They lost their kid. They lost all these different things. And they have peace. They have joy. See, it makes us, I want some of that. I want some of that. And then we step up and offer a reason for the hope that dwells in us. And then we can lead them to Christ so that they can be led beside still waters. Amen. And experience the peace of God. The last one that I wanted to talk about is, and also the alternate number is Mark 2:17. Mark 2:17 says, if you're sick and you need to get well, if you're sick and you need to get well. On hearing this, Jesus said to them, it is not the healthy who need a doctor or a physician, but the sick. I have come to call the righteous. Not to call the righteous, excuse me. I have not come to call the righteous, but the sinner. So, if you're sick and you need to get well, guys, come to him. There's another alternate number right there. He is our great physician. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to close right here. I'm going to wrap this up. And guys, just remind you, just like the song says, Jesus is on the main line. You just need to call him up. You need to tell him what you want. Amen. I want to go back to John chapter 14. You know, I missed that one, didn't I? He is the way, the truth, and the life. completely missed that one. I apologize for that. I love the scripture. I read it quite often at funerals of those who are Christians that have passed on to be with the Lord. Verse 1 says that, 14:1 says, do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms or mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I'm going. And then Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you're going. So how can we know the way? And Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to me, no one comes to the Father except through me. If you're lost, you're feeling lost. That's what I meant. I overlooked that one. But if you're lost, guys, lost your way, then that's the number you dial right there, 14:6. And he led up to this, saying that you know the way. And then Thomas asked him, how can we know the way, Lord? He told him, I am the way. So how is Jesus the way? And I mentioned Romans 10:13. Well, 10:13 is not all there is to about this either. Romans 10:13 is led up to from Apostle Paul speaks in 10:9. This is describing what you have to do to find that way. The way. And that is that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with the heart that you believe and are justified, and it's with the mouth that you confess and are saved. And then 13, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Have you done that? Have you called upon the name of the Lord? See, when it says that you believe if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and you believe in your heart that God raised him, that word believe is when you put your trust in something, that you believe in it so much that you put your trust in it. Have you put your trust in Christ? Have you asked him to be your Savior? Have you received God's salvation? You never know, guys, you never know. Somebody may go to church for all of their life and then just realize that, you know, they've never made that profession of faith. Because you can't go to church on your and get to heaven on your mom and daddy's coattails or anything like that. You can't just go to a church and think that church is going to get you into heaven. The only thing that's going to get you to heaven is just like Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one gets to the Father except by me. Have you ever made that decision in your life? I want to give you that opportunity before we have communion here today. I want to give you the opportunity to ask Christ to come into your heart and to change you, to begin a work that he promises to finish in the end in you. The altar's open, guys. If you have something that's weighing heavy on your heart, don't you dare leave this place with it. Give God glory by bringing it up here and allowing us at this church to come beside you and help you go through what you're going through. We're a hospital. We're to heal, get healed up here and get back into the battle. Amen. If you want to ask Christ in your heart, you can do it right where you're sitting, every head bowed, every eye closed. If you're in the YouTube land, I'd suggest you get down on your knees and just cry out to God at this point. This admit to him, Lord, I am a sinner. Right now, Lord, I turn from that sin. I agree, Lord, that you are right, that I am wrong, and I want to do things your way. So, Jesus, I'm asking you to come into my heart now. I receive you by faith into my spirit. I believe you died on that cross for my sins, that you rose back to life, and you're living in me now. I recognize you as my God, my Lord, and my friend. And from this moment forward, I will serve only you. In Jesus' precious, precious name. I say every Sunday, guys, if you said that prayer for the first time in your life, more importantly than that, that you felt the presence of God begin to feel the emptiness that you had, come see me right after services. And if you're on watching on YouTube and Facebook, this is my telephone number right here. If you just call me, I need to talk to you about your decision because it's the most important decision you'll ever make in your life. Amen. Well, we're fixing to get ready for communion now, and you guys at Facebook, YouTube, you got an opportunity to go get you some flat tortilla bread, just any kind of drink, grape juice preferably, but any drink that you might have around the house, because it's the heart that's the issue. It's not the what you drink or anything like that, but it's the heart that's important. Brian is going to play. Brian and Robert are going to play and sing a song here. Just the blood, oh, the blood of Jesus. And I want you to use this time to reflect. I want you to use this time to ask God to search your heart. And if you've got anything against anybody or anything like that, would you allow Him to bring that to the service? Amen. Oh yeah, I did forget that part, didn't I? Y'all can't have communion without the communion stuff, right? But just allow your God to search you, and just take this time of just meditation on God and His Word, asking to forgive you of your sins and how you so you can be, you can have communion with a clear and righteous heart. Amen. Says in Matthew 26:26, while they were eating, Jesus took bread and He gave thanks and he broke it. And he gave it to His disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body." And then He took the cup and He gave thanks and offered it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness." Father God, for this brief moment in time, Lord, we're right with You. So Father God, we've asked You to forgive us of our sins. We've asked You to search our hearts, and You did. So Father God, at least for this brief moment in time, we're right with You. And Lord, Lord Jesus, You're centered in this church where You belong because You're centered in us right now in our lives. And Lord, just we ask that You just receive this communion as a sacrifice before You, acceptable. Lord, just we love You. We praise You. We thank You, Lord. We thank You for Your love. We thank You for Your mercy. We thank You for Your grace. Father God, just until we get back up here through the next Sunday, we ask for Your perfect speed. Father God, maybe we can all gather up on the Friday at the end of the road here and just have a prayer service with you. Just a prayer booth. But Father God, we ask for your perfect speed in our lives, and we ask for your favor in our lives until then. We ask this in all things in the name of your precious Son, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
All right, guys, we love you. See you next week.